cards so we can contact you. I'll personally write you a little note. We'll send you an email. We just want to say hi and get to know you a little bit better. Okay. Westminster, have I got a deal for you? It's free, but the rewards will be priceless. The effect that you will affect eternity. Look right here. Look at these precious faces. We need help on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights to help with great people like Elizabeth and Mason. You all remember that special someone who taught you about Jesus? I remember my teachers. Do you? Well, what an impact they had on me. Well, you can sign up on the sign-up sheets right down here to help us. If you can't teach, if you can read this script, you can do it. Here's the lesson right here. All you have to do is ask the questions, read along, pause, encourage, and let the children interact with you. It's really a lot easier than you think it is. You just have to read, discuss, and talk. And those kids are precious. The behavior is awesome. You'll love it. Please sign up. We really need your help. That's for pre-K kinder for the months of May and June. Okay? And don't run. Don't walk, but run down here to sign up. Okay? Thanks in advance. Thanks, kids. April 20th is a great day. Mark it down. The doggy show is coming. It's going to be here before you know it. April 20th from 1 to 3. And we're going to also need volunteers to help with things like signing up for the people and their dogs, putting name tags on the people with the dog's names. I think we have the Young Life ready to set up tables and chairs, so all the heavy stuff will be done. But we just need help before, during, and after. And you can be on the courtesy committee also, just to walk around and be a friendly voice of Westminster. Ruckus from the Emerald Assad Poodles will be here. From 1:30 to 2:30 to hang out with us. And I know some remarkable women of the Texas Panhandle. They're going to be here to be our celebrity judges, so don't miss it. It's going to be fun, fun, fun. Also that day, we're going to have a flower sale on the sun porch. It's going to benefit our women's circle ministry. We're going to have 200 geraniums to choose from, so buy your geraniums from us on that day. Also, little Elizabeth Harder is going to be having a lemonade sale that day with baked goodies and lemonade to help her as she prepares for upcoming surgery on May the 16th. So that's our very own cause, so let's help her out. At this time, let's all stand and get ready for our call to worship. Let us worship the eternal God, the source of love and life, who created us. Let us worship Jesus Christ, the risen one, who lives among us. Let us worship the Spirit, the holy fire, who renews us. To the one true God be praise in all times and places through the grace of Jesus Christ.
Starry host, you trace the mountain peaks, you paint the evening sky with wonder. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea, all nature testifies your splendor. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Breath, praise the Lord. Spirit breathe, you formed us in your very likeness, to know your wondrous works, to tell your mighty deeds, to join the everlasting chorus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. presence of enemies. Surely goodness will follow me, follow me. In the house of God forever.
Our prayers of confession. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. We confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by the ways that lead to death. We overlook the poor and hungry. We pass by those who mourn. We are deaf to the cries of the oppressed and indifferent to the calls for peace. We despise the weak and abuse the earth you made. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of life abundant given in Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. We offer now our prayers in silence. Hear us now as we confess in silence. Our assurance of pardon. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
And strength is gone. You're the one who
At this time, will our ushers please come forward to receive the tithes and offerings? Loving God, with hearts full of gratitude, we just simply say thank you. Thank you that we get to give back to you just a small portion of what we have right now and what you've blessed us so abundantly with. Just bless these gifts as we spread your love and your grace and advance your kingdom near and far to everyone we encounter. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please be seated. For prayers of the people, this week I've been working on Song of Solomon's 2, verses 14, and it says, "Let me see your face, let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely." Let's pray. Thank you, God, that you do see us, and that you do hear us, and that you want to hear from us. Here's what I'm praying about today, God. Thank you just for the afterglow of Easter and all that it means. And may we continue to celebrate the joy of your resurrection and your hope that it brings. I hope we continue to tell everyone about that, to show them that our joy is true and real. Let them see our joy through our faces, through our words, through our text, and our actions every day. Let us run to tell people about it, not walk. God, just help us to trust what we don't see. Help us to know that you are in control, and sometimes we forget that. Help us to be the light in the darkness, to be strong when we feel weak, and to understand even when we don't understand, God. God, we just ask a blessing on all the things that go on at this church. We just say an extra blessing on our new elders and our new deacons, God. Bless them and their families as they take the time to serve us. God, bless this staff as the work that they put in so diligently and so lovingly. God, thank you for Will and Abby Jo and Sarah, Nate, myself. What an honor it is that we get to serve you like this. God, I just pray for every program that you're overseeing for us, from the little kids in the nursery to the children, to the youth, God, to our seniors, God, our Bear Paw kids and our volunteers. Help us to know that you're at work even when we don't see it. Help us to trust. God, just I ask an extra special blessing on our sick and our homebound this week. We just pray especially for Mike and Molly Swafford, for Judy Smith, for Robert Wolf, for Elizabeth Harder. Any of those I forgot to mention, God, just bless them. God, we thank you that as we pray together, the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we're going to sing Alleluia, Alleluia, Give Thanks, hymn 106. Please stand. And at this time, kids in grades K through 5, let's go have a lesson in room 116. Let's go.
Thank you. please pray with me? Dear God, as I prepare to read your word, please open our hearts to receive and understand your message for us this day. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
So I probably ought to tell you what's been going on with the spotlights there, just so you know. You see the flashing and all that? There's some part somewhere up in here that's on back order. And as soon as that comes in, everything will be fine. But speaking of light bulbs, does anybody know how many Christians it takes to change a light bulb? Well, if you're charismatic, only one. Your hands are already in the air. Episcopalians, it takes three. One to call the electrician, one to mix the drinks, and one to talk about how much better the old light bulb was. For the Baptists, it takes at least 15. You need one to change the light bulb, three committees to approve the change, and decide who brings the potato salad and the fried chicken. For the Presbyterians, change? Who said it was okay to change? Well, then, of course, there's the Amish who say, what's a light bulb? That Presbyterian response, though, is important for us today. When it comes to change, just part of being human, I think, is that we naturally resist. We naturally resist change. We resist change to our homes and the people who live there. We resist changes that happen in our bodies as we age. We resist change in friendships, routines, ways of life, our rituals, even changes in worship. Any changes, even sometimes very slight changes, can throw us off balance, disorient us, leave us with a feeling of loss and uncertainty. And as we are at this point in Scripture, I think we just need to call this out, that is how some people felt as they were watching Jesus in his ministry. They're watching what he is doing, and they are seeing changes taking place, and it leaves them feeling unsettled. We're going to look at Luke chapter 5, and we're going to be studying verses 33 through 39, but we actually need to go back and revisit some of what we looked at last week. So if you would, open your Bibles to Luke chapter 5, verse 27, and it says, After this, he went out and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, Follow me. And leaving everything, he rose and followed him. And Levi made him a great feast in his house, and there was a large company of tax collectors and others reclining at table with them. And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And Jesus answered them, Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So you see in this part of the passage, which we talked about a lot last week, and so I'm not going to go over too much of it, but you see Jesus here is forgiving Levi, a tax collector, the worst of the worst, and is calling him to be a disciple. And Levi responds to this by throwing a party and celebrating and calling his other tax collector friends and his other sinner friends to come with him. And he says, Jesus, come to my party. Everyone's going to be there. And Jesus goes. And you see this reaction from the Pharisees and from their scribes, because this is a significant change in what anyone would have expected. Nobody would have expected a teacher or even a wholly respected man in this religious community to go to a place like that with people like that. And so as the Pharisees and their scribes, and we can assume even some people, other people in the community, as they are looking at this, they are feeling disoriented, discombobulated, if you will, befuddled and perplexed. Yes, befuddled. Then they start to notice. This is not the only change that we have seen. This is not the only difference that's happening here. There are more changes going on. And so the Pharisees, they get together with some of the disciples of John the Baptist, and they start talking, and they're looking at the way John's disciples are doing things. And then they look at Jesus, and Jesus is having a feast, and his followers are feasting with him, and they're celebrating. And then they start to say, you know, have we ever seen them fasting? Have we ever seen them doing things the way that we do things? And so they go and they say, well, why are we fasting and Jesus' disciples aren't? And so we see here in verse 33, and they said to him, they being the Pharisees and scribes and some of John's disciples, they said to him, the disciples of John fast often and offer prayers, and so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink. Now, there's no question mark in there, but they're saying this in a way that it's a question, and we can see that because Jesus responds to it. But why? Why are they putting this out there for Jesus to respond to? Maybe they're asking for clarification. Maybe there is a sense of offense, you know, when you see somebody else, you know, you're not doing it right. And we can get offended by that. Maybe it's just confusion. I would say it is at least confusion. Because here are these people, and they have their own idea of how to respond to sinners. They have their own idea of how they should respond in this situation, and they have centuries of experience with this. Having a party with a tax collector and other sinners is not their way. This is a significant change. What they would have done is they would have done what they had been doing. Push them out. Marginalize them. Keep those who are holy close. Keep those who are doing everything right, like us, keep them close. Push the sinners out there. This is our place. That's your place. Respect the boundary. Stay over there. But that's not what Jesus was doing, was it? In fact, as we read through the Gospels, and we're going to see more of this as we go, it seems like the bigger the sinner was, the closer Jesus got to them. We know part of the reason. Jesus said it in verse 32. We already read it. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. In other words, Jesus only came to save one type of person. There's only one type of person that Jesus came to save. Sinners. But then Jesus goes on, and given what they have to say, he's going to clue them in to something bigger. Look in verse 34 and 35. It says, Jesus said to them, can you make wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast in those days. So he starts off and he's saying, look, as far as the fasting goes, there will come a time for that, but that time is not now. You wouldn't go to a wedding with, you know, all of the best food and all the people celebrating and walk around, you know, the Charlie Brown music playing in the background, you know, woe is me. Oh, I can't eat any of that, I'm fasting, right? He's saying this is a time for celebration because I am here. The time for fasting will come. But then he goes on and he says this, and I'll tell you, as I was growing up, this always confused me. He told them a parable. No one tears a piece from a new garment and puts it on an old garment. If he does, he will tear the new, and the piece from the new will not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst the skins, and it will be spilled, and the skins will be destroyed. But new wine must be put into fresh wineskins. What is Jesus saying in this moment? What is he saying with this parable? Well, to kind of bring it forward maybe to the modern day, so my kids, you know, they like to run and slide and, you know, crawl across the ground, you know, on their knees and stuff. And so when they're in their school pants, you know, if you flip them inside out, you can see there's like extra cloth on the knees because the people that make these, they know, right? It's going to happen. They're going to be crawling everywhere. And so especially my younger kids, you know, they've come home and they've got these holes in the knees of their pants. It's like, what are you doing? Well, I had to go from here to there. Well, we use feet. No, I crawled and I slid. And so they get these holes in their knees. Now, here's what would be silly. If we said, okay, you have holes in these pants, we need to fix that. So we're going to go to the store. We're going to buy a new pair of pants. And they're probably even a different color, different pattern, I don't know. But we're going to get these new pants and we're going to bring them home. And then we're going to cut the knees out, and we're going to sew them on right there for you. Problem solved, right? No, that would be ridiculous. Why would you do that? Why would you go get the new pants and cut them up just to patch the knees in the old pants? You have a new garment. Don't cut it up to patch the old. Or you can take the other piece of the parable where Jesus is talking about the wineskins, and so... So one of the things that you may not know about me is early on in my marriage, Anna and I, like, you know, if we ever got takeout and we had leftovers, you know, you'd have that styrofoam and it's like, there's only enough leftovers for one person. And so you would be somewhere in the apartment and you'd hear the ding of the microwave and it's like, the race is on. You know, it's like, okay, I've got to get this out of the microwave, run to the bathroom, the only room in the apartment that has a lock on the door, get in there, and I got to chow this thing down before someone else hears and comes over and wants some. Right? But sometimes in our zeal, we'd throw that in there and we'd heat it up, and that styrofoam, it would just melt around it. And you'd get to the bottom, and you're just like trying to pick that crispy noodle out of this styrofoam, and not, you know, it's probably not very good for us anyway. But here's the thing that would be absurd, is if you got fresh food, and you cooked it in the styrofoam, and that whole thing just melts around it, and now the whole thing is ruined. Nobody gets the first round. Nobody gets leftovers. The whole thing's just done. Why? Because that container wasn't meant to hold that food. It wasn't meant to cook that food in it. You can't do that. What Jesus is saying with the wine and the wineskins is he's saying, look, you've got new wine. You have to put it in new wineskins because as that is fermenting, as it's aging, as it's cooking, so to speak, it's going to expand. And you need the right container to hold it. You need the right thing to put it in that's going to expand with it, that can hold it. Otherwise, it's all going to burst. Everything is going to go down. Jesus is using these two different ways to tell them that there is something new coming. I am doing something new that the old cannot contain. I am doing something new, and it's not a patch on something. It is time for the old to be set aside. It is time for the old to be fulfilled and to be put over here. I am doing something new, and the old way can't hold it. We can't put it in there. It won't fit. It's not right. It won't work. It is time to move on to the new way and the new thing. And so Jesus here, as they're questioning him about fasting, he's saying, look, you guys are so focused on this old thing, but God is doing something new. God is doing something new. And you haven't even imagined yet what it might be. So the next question for us, in order to understand this, is what is the old? What is the new? What do these things represent? Well, if the people knew what Jesus was talking about, they probably would have tried to kill him right there. Because Jesus was talking about the old covenant and the new covenant. Jesus was talking about the old covenant and the new covenant. Now, this is a word that's not very familiar to us, covenant. But it's like a promise. It's like a contract. Oftentimes, there would be a ceremony. There would be vows. There were always obligations as part of this and penalties for not fulfilling your obligations or for rebelling against your obligations. And so you would have this covenant, this contract, this promise, and the promise would be, okay, you do this and I'll do that. You know, you love me, I'll respect you. You pay your taxes, I'll protect you. I'll build roads, right? Things like that. We can think about those. But what it was is it was this binding commitment of obligations to each other, and there were benefits for following the terms, and there were penalties for rebelling against the terms. And so in the old covenant, what God said is, he said, I will be your God, and you will be my people. And here are the terms. Here are the laws to follow: clean foods, unclean foods, the holidays you'll do, the practices you'll do, you know, keep things kosher, etc. And then, here are the penalties if you rebel against this. Now, we know the point of all this, and you can look back at Exodus 19, and if you just want to turn there real quick in your Bibles, Exodus 19, second book in the Bible, very near the beginning. Exodus 19, look at verse 4 through 6. He says, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians. So he's brought the people of Israel out of their slavery in Egypt. He says, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and I brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my, what, covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. So here, what is God saying? He's brought the people out of Egypt, right? This is his grace in action. When they were helpless, he came and he helped them. And he brings them into his relationship with himself. And he says, look, you're going to know me. And you will be my people. And I will bless you and I will care for you. And I will do all of these things for you. And through you, the whole world is going to know who I am. Right? It's that Genesis story. God created us to know him and to love him and to live in relationship with him. And then Adam and Eve rebelled, and then you have this whole thing of getting back to God coming after his people saying, I want relationship with you, and I want you to know me, and here's how we're going to do it. And so he forms these covenants with Israel. But here's the problem. So the lottery's huge now. I don't know how big it is. I don't even know if anybody won it last night. If you won it, let's talk about tithing. Here's the thing. You hear the statistics, right? Someone who doesn't have a lot of resources, they finally win the lottery, they hit it big, and then how long before they're poor again? They could win the lottery 10 more times, and it would happen 10 more times. Up, down, up, down, up, down. That cycle keeps happening. Here's the thing. Israel hit the spiritual jackpot. The God of the universe comes and he says, I want relationship with you. I've saved you. You're going to be my people. Here's how this is going to work, right? And then rebellion after rebellion after rebellion. And then God, in his grace, he waits and he waits and he waits and he doesn't you know, come down hard on them like he could. But then again, they just rebel and they rebel. And he keeps saying, come back to me, come back to me, come back to me. And he keeps making a way for the people to come back to him. But they just can't get it. They cannot keep the terms. They can't uphold their end of the agreement. And so what does God do? He makes a promise in Jeremiah that we heard Carol read. And I love what one man said about it. A guy named Michael Williams said this. He said, what is new is that God is going to address the issue of Israel's inability to keep the covenant. He will cure the disease of sin. Sinful hearts have been the problem since the beginning. The new covenant, however, will know such a full forgiveness of sins that Yahweh will remember sin no more. And then the sin problem will be finally and definitively dealt with. Sin will no longer be a problem. Covenant breach will come to an end. Jeremiah depicts the new covenant as unilaterally or monergistically imposed. Listen to this. There is no talk here of Israel's covenant obligation, no mutuality. It is all a sovereign work. I will make, I will put, I will write, I will be their God. And finally and climactically, I will forgive, I will remember sin no more. What is God saying? Through Jeremiah, he was saying, you couldn't keep the old covenant. You couldn't do it. So I will do it for you. And what Jesus is saying is he's saying, this time is here. It is approaching. I'm going to do it for you. I'm going to keep this covenant for you. And then I will give myself to make a new covenant that you can't break. How could that ever fit inside the old system? How could that ever fit in the old way? It couldn't. You need a new garment. You need the new wine. And Jesus is pointing forward to how he will do it. We know how he did it. We just talked about it last week. He does it by taking the penalty of rebellion against that old covenant onto himself. All of that rebellion, all of those times of not keeping it, all of those times of failing, Jesus says, I will pay the penalty. I will pay the covenant penalty myself. And that is what he did on the cross. All of the debt stored up of all of our failure, he paid it. So that on the cross, he was saying, I have paid your debt, all of it, yesterday, now, tomorrow, forever. I have paid it in full. And all you have to do to receive the benefit of that is accept it. Jesus talks about this all through the Gospels. Repent and believe. Repent and believe. Say, Jesus, I was guilty, but I want what you have for me. Forgive me. Repent and believe. Accept the benefit of what Jesus has done. Take the old pair of jeans with the holes in the knees and stop holding on to them. Set them aside. Put them away. You don't need them anymore. Take the new garment that Jesus has for you. That's what Jesus is talking about. Have you done that? Have you repented? Do you believe? Have you said, Jesus, take the old off of me? The filthy rags, the clothes with holes in them, everything that I've tried to clothe myself in, take them with all the patches I've tried to put on there. Take it away and give me what's new. Jesus will clothe you with his own righteousness, with all of his covenant faithfulness. And God will forever see you in that way. The old has passed away. The new has come. Now, that is the first and primary way that we should respond. Jesus, take this old, put it away, take it off of me. You could even think about, if anyone, you know, Pilgrim's Progress, anybody read that or maybe watched it, I think there have been some shows of it, right? He goes to the foot of the cross and this burden that he's been carrying falls off, right? That's the first thing. Go to Jesus. Let him do that for you. But then how should we respond? There are lots of ways that we could respond to this, but I just want to mention a few. The first one is this: continue to go to him with our failures. We need to continue to go to him with our failures. Why? Because the greater the sin, the greater the mercy, the greater the compassion, the greater the love of Christ that will envelop you. I love the way Dane Ortlund put it, this pastor named Dane Ortlund. He said, "Do not minimize your sin or excuse it away. Raise no defense. Simply take it to the one who is already at the right hand of the Father, advocating for you on the basis of his own wounds. Let your own unrighteousness, in all your darkness and despair, drive you to Jesus Christ, the righteous, in all his brightness and sufficiency." Have you ever wondered why we have a confession of sin and an assurance of pardon every single week? We're doing this. We're going to Jesus and we're saying, "Jesus, can you remind me of the robes that you have clothed me in? Jesus, can you wash off the dirt and the mud of the world that I've walked through, willingly or unwillingly? Can you wash away the dirt that has been thrown on me?" Week after week, we go to Jesus with our failures, and you can do this day after day, minute after minute, if you have to. So that is the first thing. Continue to go to him with our failures. The second thing is this: reject self-pity. Reject self-pity. What is self-pity anyway? Self-pity, I'm just the worst, aren't I? Oh, I can't even believe, ugh. You know, that's when you cue the Charlie Brown music and walk your way towards the door. Why? Why do we do that? Well, there are two aspects to it. One is it's like, okay, if I just punish myself enough, then I don't have to worry about whatever I did. God, I'm a worm. Doesn't work. The other thing we do with it is we try and earn sympathy. We want other people to go, "You're not that bad. It's not that bad. You're okay," right? And we want to earn that sympathy. Here's the thing, though. It doesn't work because we didn't earn God's love in the first place. That's the whole point of what Jesus is doing. That's the whole point of this new covenant. There's no other side to that. Jesus rushes in with all of his love and rescues us when we were pathetic. You didn't earn God's love. That means that you cannot earn more and you cannot earn less. You cannot earn more with your good behavior. You cannot earn less with your bad behavior. If you are a believer, you have nothing to lose and nothing to gain through self-pity. You have nothing to lose and nothing to gain through self-pity. Instead, through faith, we are called to believe that God's grace is enough for us. Day after day after day, it is God's grace alone in Christ that saves us. So reject self-pity. And when you find yourself starting to walk down that road, starting to try and heap some things on your back, remember, it's not going to do anything for you except make you feel bad and make other people not want to be around you. Don't do that. We don't need to do that. But here's the other thing. We can also reject judgmentalism. We can reject judgmentalism. Look at verse 39, Luke 5, verse 39. Jesus says this, "And no one, after drinking old wine, desires new, for he says the old is good." He's talking specifically to these Pharisees and these scribes. Why? because he knows what's in their hearts. He just heard about it after Levi's party, and he knows what's in their hearts, and they're saying, look, I don't need this new way. I can make it my own way. I like my own way. I am not a sinner like them. And that's why they push so hard for that divide. And we talked last week about this comparison and how the only way that's going to work, you put you in a cycle of constantly having to find someone to compare yourself to make yourself better. And if you can't find them, then you'll create it in them. And Jesus is saying, look, that's a real temptation, and it's a real temptation probably for every believer. In fact, the biggest reason that is given for the dislike of Christians and Christianity in general is what? They're judgmental. They're judgmental, right? There is no room for us to be judgmental in Christianity. Look at Ephesians 2, verse 8 through 10. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works. Hear this, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. There is no room for being judgmental in Christianity, for saying, I'm better than you. Hey, I don't want to point this out, but you know I'm better than you, right? Giving people the looks, you know the look. You've either had the look, maybe you've given the look. I'm not here to judge, right? Right? There's no room for that. There is no room for that in Christianity. Why? We should be the least judgmental people on earth because we are beneficiaries of a forgiveness that we did not earn. So no looks of scorn. We deserve a look of scorn, and Jesus doesn't give it. No surprise when sinners sin, right? People that are far from God. Jesus wasn't surprised when he went to this party and there were tax collectors there. He wasn't surprised when he went to this party and there were sinners there and they sinned. That's what sinners do. One of my favorite, you know, stickers has John Calvin, and he's wearing these sunglasses, and it says, heathens gonna heave. Right? Sinners are gonna sin. Heathens gonna heave. We shouldn't be surprised by that. Reject judgmentalism. We have been saved by grace, just as we hope everyone else that we love will be saved by grace. So reject self-pity, reject judgmentalism, and instead, we should have an overwhelming joy when anyone turns to Jesus. Just like Levi, who in his repentance finds joy, and he throws a party, and he says, Jesus, everyone's going to be there, and you need to meet them. They need to meet you. They need to hear about this God who loves sinners. And he throws a party, and one day we will have a party in paradise. There was a man that we've talked about quite a bit in here who exemplifies some of this. John Newton, who wrote Amazing Grace, you know, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. In his early life, as some of you know, he was, heathen's gonna heathe. He tried to heathe more than any heathen had ever heathed. He made it his goal. And this is the Will Esler paraphrase. He made it his goal to give the devil a run for his money. And he got kicked off of ships. He, even though he was in the slave trade, then he was getting sold into the slave trade. But eventually, God changed him, got a hold of him, and he changed him. And he became a pastor. And if you go to England, you can go to the churches where he pastored. You can read about some of his experiences. And one of my favorite things that he ever said, I think, exemplifies some of this response that we're talking about. He said this, and we'll close with this. If I ever reach heaven, I expect to find three great surprises there. First, to meet someone I had not thought to see there. Second, to miss someone I had expected to see there. And third, the greatest wonder of all, to find myself there. Let's pray. Jesus, your mercy is overwhelming. And sometimes it feels beyond belief. We believe, help our unbelief. Jesus, as we turn to you, because you have drawn us to us, help us to see ourselves as we are, flawed, sinful, and yet loved and redeemed at the cost of your own life. Jesus, help us to live out of that truth, out of that reality, each and every day. And when we stray from it, hold us close. Rush in with your mercy like a flood. Surround us with your love. Help us to be a people who are known for our love. Help us to be a people that call others to repentance and belief in the God who loves sinners like us. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand as we continue. As we come to this table, we know that this is a reminder for us of the great love of Christ, the great mercy of Christ, and the price that he paid for our forgiveness and for this new covenant. This is not a Presbyterian table, this is the Lord's table, so all are welcome at this if your faith is in Christ. As we do this, we'll be doing this through intinction, so you'll come up and you'll get a piece of the bread, dip it in the cup, and then take that on your way back to your seat. If you don't want to do that for any reason, we do have some of these little cups up here that you can take with you as well. Parents, you know where your kids are in their journey of faith better than we do, and so if you feel like your kids are not ready for communion, then what we invite you to do is get a little bit bigger of a piece of bread and then give them some of your own as we share our faith with our children. And then off to the side, we'll have these grapes, and that's just there to symbolize that as a grape grows and matures into wine, so we believe that their faith will grow and mature into saving faith. We are trusting our Lord for that. So as we come to this table, let's pray. Father, we thank you for what you're doing here. Holy Spirit, we thank you that through this meal, you are active in our hearts, that you are giving us spiritual food for the journey ahead. Be with us in this, we pray. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And at the end of the meal, he took the cup and poured it, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Drink this in remembrance of me." The Apostle Paul tells us then that as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes again. And what do we know and believe? He is coming again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Would the elders please come forward? Hear now this several thousand-year-old benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.